Good afternoon, everybody. I'm delighted to be invited to give a presentation here. I'm very surprised with the large numbers that I find here. I've just arrived this morning, an hour ago. You have to help me a little bit. You are all professionals, and I hope you are used during your education already to see a lot of images very fast, because we have to go through a large number of slides. But I hope they are very visual, so I hope it will go smoothly. I will hit about on these five topics. A short introduction is this was an image of my work in Kisumu, and I wrote a book on earth architecture afterwards, 10 years later. This was in my 20s in Kisumu. In my 30s I worked in Lamu briefly, half a year, 9 months, something like that. And I tried to work with the NMK on a professional monuments care policy. Not much came out of it so far. And I'm a member of AHEC, as you see the right-hand picture. This just to introduce myself. I would like to say a few things about architecture in Kenya. And it's more diverse than you might think. Maybe you're not Luke, well, you're all professional, so of course you know a lot about what you find in Kenya. A few things about the context. Strangers, tribes have always moved around. Maybe they still do so. But the strangers came with a lot of new influences over the sea, basically. And then, of course, the railroad was built, the English administration came, etc. And they brought a lot of new ideas and images in Kenya, especially on the White Highlands. Beginning, maybe it was understandable that they thought the land was empty, but in the end it wasn't at all. It went completely out of hand, you could say. Just a few words on the background, and you can see that the population with the start of the railway, it was less than, if this is 10 million, then there's less than 5 million. It's just a few people living in Kenya compared to what it is now, and it's 43 at the moment, I think. It goes very fast. Meaning that the older buildings, of course, are only a small portion of what you find at this moment in Kenya. In just a few decades, early 20th century, a dramatic change in the country, cash crop development, new landscapes, building types, new building types, public spaces was in a new form, and a built infrastructure. So if you look at the first houses built by Europeans, they used the local building technique available, but eventually they built a house as their fathers would be proud of them. This is an example I found in literature. And also this building, the initial house where the family stayed was this, and the final house they built was this one, completely new image in Kenya. And it's still there, by the way, in Rongai. This is Delorine. Now my remote doesn't work. Yeah. Other pioneers had more modest houses like this one in Molo, and even this one, built by a farmer, he tried to create beauty by making a symmetrical setup with his wing projecting towards the view, and it's still inhabited by his daughter, and it's a kind of a time machine when you enter this house, as it is still in its original with its original interior, as you can see on these images. Then the shops. Oh, something goes. Oh. Is there a battery problem? The images are important for the story, so. Yeah, we're there. Another image, of course, were the many shops by the Indian salesmen, and they also tried to create something. Churches, new religion came to Kenya, and this is one of the oldest churches in Kenya. And the built infrastructure, the railway, with its fantastic bridges in Turi, I'm sure you came across them. Fantastic, fantastic constructions. This is a completely new landscape. Can you imagine that you were living in 1900 in Kenya and suddenly you saw this landscape with just one cash crop, something completely new. And these White Highland things, it's a bit difficult to see this image. I took it from the air. This is in Kikuyu, this is around Kiricho, but I think Kikuyu people still call it the line in the landscape, and you can Google it. I mean, I invite you to do that. You can see the line here of the White Highlands. I'm looking for my binoculars. This one, the traditional landscape. You find it on the right side and on the left side, a completely different scale. You can still see the image from the air. Roads were built, but they were also made into lanes with beautiful trees. You find them a lot in the country, out country, Nakuru. Public parks, it's also a new feature with fountains or monuments. And this is a nice staircase in Kisumu, very well designed. These were all completely new things. And these new things came in certain styles. These are the styles I would like to address briefly with just a few examples. This direction, yeah. Arts and crafts. A commercial, that's a wrong word. My English is sometimes leaving me. I'm sorry for that. Arts and crafts, it was a traditional fashion in English architecture, European architecture. You also find it in the Netherlands, the country I'm from. Going back after the 19th century with all the industrialization, you found a new style. Let's go back to nature. Let's use natural materials. And these are some of the results in that style in Kenya. A large farmhouse in Rongai, and this theater in Nakuru, and the interior. A nice church in Joro. And this, it's almost a castle, you know. Can you imagine it was built in 1957? It could have been also designed by, what's this British architect, Inigo Jones in 1657. But you still find it here. It's a kind of romantic, robust building. This style is not just the Norfolk Hotel, but also in Elbergen you find an example of this. The Egerton Castle, I'm sure most of you have visited once in your life. An amazing structure. Bathrooms, very beautiful church. Somewhere in Nyanza, Rangala. Very nice detailing, brickwork. The famous Dutch gable, as you see it here. You find it a lot in South Africa. And according to what I read, many South African farmers came to the region. I think it was called 64. Was in Gishu around Eldoret. And so you find a few of these gables in. Well, you also see them in Nairobi. But you find many in Eldoret. And a part of this arts and crafts movement, which was more or less a romantic movement, traditional movement, they developed on a town planning scale the garden city. And you have a beautiful example in Nairobi, Karoleni. I'm sure you know it. And it's under threat, I think. They want to demolish a part of it. I don't know precisely. Anyway, let's go to a next style. In Europe you find this style before the Industrial Revolution, but in Kenya you find it after the arts and crafts a little bit. So in the 20s, 30s, many of these buildings were built. It was a serious colony, so we need arrogant buildings. This is the power of the new government, and this kind of features were built. Well, these are the most famous examples, of course, in Nairobi, and the old Grindley's Bank. And it's still an appealing style, as you can see in the toilet building that was built in front of this building. For example, Kisumu now demolished this building, by the way. And this elegant building was also demolished this year. I discovered that it's gone. The Gilani Butchery in Nakuru. And this is a unique example because of the roof lantern you see here. Look at, there are some two features on the corners of the roof. Very nice one. It's the only one I know in Kenya, but it's gone, unfortunately. This is a stone variation in Nairobi downtown, and this symmetrical building, and see the two lions near the gate. You see the small ones. And they all have a style, very funny. The Elbergen shops all have square column heads, and the Olkala ones have round ones. So there was a traveling contractor, I think, who built the whole mall in one. It would be a nice subject for an investigation. Indian religious architecture, Hinduism, and this example in Sika, could have been any other country far away. And then independence came, and modernism, a universal style created by architects. It started already in the 30s in various places like Le Corbusier. And let's not create an image of power or of romance, but let's just look at a functional way at a building. So when there's a window needed, you make a window, and you don't bother about symmetry or other things. Of course, modernism was also mixed with all kinds of aesthetic ideas, and you find modernism at very prime locations, especially in Africa. Africa is famous for its modernist architecture. As you can read in several books by Kulterman or Folkert. Well, this is Nairobi in that period of building a new nation, and many of these buildings were built in that period. The Nakuru railway station, do you realize that the main shopping street in Nakuru, it's directly in line with the clock tower of the railway station, so you can always see how many hours you still have for shopping before taking the train to whichever direction. An example in Kisumu, and also upcountry in Molo, very nice shop with details. Modernist movement in Europe is very famous for its housing project, and one of the chief architects, Ernst May, he also worked from Germany. He also worked in Kenya, I think it was 15 years. A nice book is published about his Kenyan projects. Find it in the Goethe Institute. But they are famous for public housing, and this is an example in Kisumu. And another one here. We have the ventilation coming in on the first floor. The ground floor you can use for other things, double ground use. And the KFA apparently also had an architect who knew how to do it. You find these, this is a high quality design, I think. And a cinema is a place for fantasy, and this fantastic design for a fantasy building in Nakuru. If you take away the later additions, you see a symmetrical setup with this roof and this canopy. It's a nice way of doing it. Ceiling inside. And this cinema, you know, of course, in Gara Street, is now a theater in Gara Road. What was the name of it? Sarikasi Dome, I think. Very beautiful staircase. And even this simple structure in Isiolo, it creates some kind of a fantasy with these Mabati, curved Mabati sheets. Very simple design, but very, very rewarding. Architects also often try it to bring a local feature into it. And I've always considered, even when I was young in my 20s, that this was a very nice building. It gives like a pile of agricultural stuff. And Maridadi you find on the Kakahawa house and all kinds of other buildings. This bank in Kisumu has a nice ceiling. And this building in this 1950s office building in the center of Nairobi, it's almost like a fabric of a beautiful for a beautiful dress, an African fabric to it, and it's created in concrete. An African inspiration of another kind. I think this was built by prisoners of war from Italy, and they built traditional huts but in stone. And you see them in the landscape. It's a very funny. It's a very weird building. And they are empty, but I think it's a cool place to live. And the new era brought all kinds of new fantasies and new designs. There's no limit to shape, you could say, in the last decades in Kenya. The temple in Nairobi, with its curved columns, by the Hungarian architect, George Vamos. I think he also built this building in Sika, of a weird, well, what shall I say, a weird form. The cathedral in Nakuru, the new one. I have a picture of the old one later. The new fantasies, well, I'm sure you recognize this style, all kinds of possibilities, and the building boom that's going on at the moment. It's still following this course, this fashion. However, my story is there's a very interesting, how do you say, amount of buildings in Kenya that's worth seeing forever, seeing in the future. We shouldn't demolish it all, that's what I think. And for instance, this building, I showed it to you already previously, you see the new buildings coming up next to it. This is how I saw it in 2013, and the following year it wasn't there. This nice house, one of these farmers' houses, but a very rare example of a double-story house upcountry, close to, not far from Nakuru. This is how I found it in 2007, and 2 years later the floors have gone already, and of course the building is no longer there, even the chimney is now demolished. The Standard Bank, 1913, a very fatal fire, and it's still an empty plot. The tallest building at that period in Nairobi was the Nairobi House, that's this one. It's now incorporated in the town by the 50s, and in 1982 it was demolished, and there was an argument because it was a listed monument, and even today it's an empty plot. Can you imagine how, what a pity, we lost the building, but it's not even something better that came on the same spot. A nice Art Deco building in Nakuru, and it's now this building. It's not a bad design, but it's a pity the old one is gone. So why did it have to be on that particular spot? It could have been built anywhere else. Well, you know, if you travel by public means in Nairobi, they all go to Odeon, but Odeon is no longer Odeon. But the name people call it is still Odeon. And of course, this Florida nightclub, remembrance, I think, for 3 generations of Kenyan men, you know, it's gone. And it's a pity, I think, because all these buildings have their own story. They tell something about the history, and you shouldn't let it go. We have to build a force against it. But let's look a little bit, what can we do? That's the potential of these old buildings. Because many people all like to replace them, because that's modernity, that's progress, that's development. We have to proceed. But I think you can do something very clever with old buildings. I live in Amsterdam, so I have a few examples from Amsterdam. This was a building, it's not even a very old one. You find it here. But within 10 years after building, it was no longer needed and it became empty. And they changed it into housing. So it is an office changed into housing. So what did they do? They added one floor here, and they added balconies. It's very simple, the elevation is, the facades are more or less the same, but it's a new, it created the same image, but it is a new function inside, completely new. This one, it was a very iconic modernist building, built in the 50s, I think. You can see the two top pictures. Iconic building next to the highway, green glass. The whole country was speaking about it. It was completely stripped, and now there are studios for young creative companies. You can rent a small space, you can buy or rent it. It's still the same image, but it's a new function inside. This church, I'm sorry to say, but many people in Holland are not going to church anymore. And they used to go very often in the 60s, let's say up to the 60s. So many churches become empty, but in a small village or in a town, they are often very strong images of the place. So the municipality often decides, let's keep the building, because we need it as it gives us an identity, the building. So this it's not a very large church. This was the church as it was, and this was the proposal. I found these images. I should have mentioned the name of the architect here in this slide. I'm sorry for that. The nave is still there, but he is using the ales to build his offices. So now it's an office building. this was the there was a new feature in Amsterdam town, I think it was 1913, that the electrical tramway was built. And they built at the edge of the, at the fringe of the city, they built a large complex of buildings to put all the tram lines in. The tram would be here at night, and there would be workshops, etc., etc. And it became empty, and there were protests in the neighborhood that it shouldn't go away, it's a nice feature, we should keep it. It was very difficult to find financing, but after I think 5 or 10 years of quarreling about it, this was the original interior, they made a design. So these are the renovated old buildings with all kinds of cultural functions in it. And here is a new housing scheme, and the profit made here was used to renovate the other part. And this is how it looks inside. There's a hotel inside now, built inside the old building. And that's the entrance of the hotel. And other functions are a library, the inner street, all kinds of restaurants, and it became a very popular hotspot in town, Amsterdam. But let's go back to Kenya. We have a few examples in Kenya where maintenance is also very helpful. The G&G gardens are in a much better condition than they were perhaps 10 to 15 years ago. This is a well-maintained house in Rongai, including the interior. And this house, well-maintained, you can renovate it. There's a new roof on this church in Molo, and it's beautiful, it's still there. This building in Kisumu was renovated. This was more or less the old appearance, and it now looks this way. You can change the function. This was the old cathedral of Nakuru, and they also did a conversion here, that the nave is also used for offices, and the aisles were built in with these walls. It's a simple example, but I mean, you can still do that because the diocese wanted the old church to remain there as a remembrance of the past. And this is a very funny way. It's a classicist building, bank building, in Eldoret, and with a modernist addition to it. Famous extensions, of course, the hotel in Nairobi, also our country, you find several of these extensions. And there are lots of opportunities.
Yet we, as an association, and I mean there as well, we have not taken a position. We seem to buy into the idea that this renewal is a solution to the housing problem. So in my opinion, maybe we should be offering them constructive ideas to move the proposal they have to somewhere very far and give transport systems that will still enable these people to live far and find their way to the industrial area or find their way to the city center or to the places where they work, so that we retain histories. Because in most of these situations, we are killing the images, the experiences, that old environment. Because I can give an example of a place like in Eastlands, in Jerusalem or Jericho. The housing estates have very ideal play areas for children and other facilities, social amenities like shopping, parking, in the old style. Yet you don't find that anymore. And we have failed to learn even from Lavington or Kileleshwa, where the old houses were demolished and we are now putting up high-rise apartments. Is it any better? I don't think it is, but we want to go that way again in Eastlands to kill that. So my call is for the association. Maybe I'm asking our president, when we work hard, we also become what? Activists. Thank you very much.
Okay, activists. So. Yeah,
thank you, and for that very good presentation, which has taken me down the memory line, rather, especially for Nairobi. I'm the director of city planning for a couple of years. And what is coming out is that we have actually planned to balance development, conservation, and heritage. The issue of conservation and heritage, actually, within our profession, is actually given a back stage. And unless we take it seriously, very soon we have no history actually to, we have no history as far as our development is concerned. I have seen the issue of the Nairobi House has been raised in the presentation. And for those who don't know this properly, Nairobi House is the building which was opposite New Stanley, and which we, as approving authority then, specifically we said this is a historical building, but the then Attorney General said there is no history about it. We have the issue of the Starlight. Starlight has had very good history, and for those who don't know, Starlight is where we have the current integrated house. Originally it was a church, it became a club. Those people who used to patronize it, it was actually one of the top clubs in the city. And in spite of us raising issues that it is a historical site in one way or another, then we are advised it has no history, and it went. So what I'm coming to is that unless we as a professional body we put pressure on issues for conservation and heritage, this country actually will have no history and heritage to refer to. So what are we doing? All these building plans are submitted by you, and even the gentleman who has just talked, if he has given an old building, he has no time to recourse to history to see how this building came. His is the 6%. I'm not referring to you. It is the issue of the 6%, and then you have the history go. Gentlemen and ladies, we have a lot of history behind the Tomboya Street. We call it Zone 3 of the city. The King Croc, all those Accra Road, they have very good architecture. How much time do we take actually to run that to see how we can be able to conserve our city? You have been shown pictures of Amsterdam. I'm very familiar with Amsterdam and the Dutch architecture. And with them, they do renovations. Actually, it is very rare that you can find a building coming down unless a lot of critiques has gone into it. So it is restored the way it is. The way we restored Kipande House, it was done through the underpinning, conservation building. So what I'm saying is, we should take into account the issue of conservation. And even if you are given an assignment to do a 30-story building, question it and say, let me forego my 6%. As far as my concerns is concerned, this building should remain. How many of us have that capacity to advise? So this is the challenge which has come from the presenter. And it's a very good presentation, and I acknowledge it. And that is the line, that is the route that we should not take. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think we have two comments. I think I'll ask Eden to come and just give a general comment very, very briefly concerning those comments, and then we'll go to the next one.
Well, thank you for the two questions. Well, maybe there were more comments indeed, as you said. So I have a feeling there are lots of thoughts among ourselves on this topic, and I would suggest let's have a further discussion on this maybe next time. You never know what the future will bring. What can we do, and how can we present cases? How can we improve this system? Contests, awards, I don't know. There are all kinds of things you can use to bring this subject on the table with the partners we have to deal with as architects. Is that a short enough?
Thank you.